great to see kids running and having fun in our church, amen? You know, it's like backyard Bible clubs. First of all, I just should have did this during my welcome, but I just want to thank everyone who had anything to do with backyard Bible club, from bringing cookies to serving down there to whatever location you may have served at. I know we have some who served at another location, and I think, Mandy, didn't you say New Salem had 19 to 20 some kids and 19 to 21 every night? We had about 10 at ours. But, you know, most of the locations had about that number. They had a small number, but you have to remember there were locations all over Pike County. So there were so many kids that got ministered to. And I know at our location, I just want to share with you real quick, you know, our story time kind of, at the last moment, the storyteller couldn't make it, so we had to step up. But we told the story, and the kids got it. They understood it. And when it came time for prayer time, I've never heard such awesome prayers and what they got out of the lesson. You know, I mean, it was like they had to come up with a praise from the lesson and a thanksgiving for the lesson and then forgiveness for the lesson and then an ask, please, Lord. You know, and it was just like, I was telling Bible group this morning, I said, most time when kids ask the Lord for something, right, it's like, my cat is sick or I need a new Nintendo. But, you know, it was like, my mom needs a job. You know, we can pray for those things. And we did. And it was just so great to see kids' hearts. And then down here at the celebration night at Nazarene Church, I got dunked like 75 times. So, which I'm a little waterlogged this morning, but that's okay because I'm going to count that on our annual church profile for baptisms this year. So I went under, like I said, 75 times. So there you go. So, but it was a good time. So thank you all for that. And it's just been a great thing. You know, it's just been as I said, I think it's been a great summer for kids from church camp to backyard Bible club. I mean, it's just been a good year for kids in our community and our church. So anyway, I believe today is like the seventh week in our sermon series in Acts. I don't know how that works. We're only in chapter 3, but it's been 7 weeks. But anyway, as we've seen as we've gone through this book of Acts, we've seen some pretty amazing things. Things that God was doing in the early church. And not just the early church, you have to remember, this is the infant church. The church had just started, and it was an infant church, and God was performing miraculous signs and wonders and deeds by using ordinary men and women. And the Lord is still using ordinary men and women to do amazing things in the church and in the world. You know, some people don't realize what's going on sometimes and all the great things that's happening that God is involved. Well, that's just chance. That's just happenstance. That's just something, right? But God's still doing amazing things in his church and in the world. And just like we will see back then, the people God uses to accomplish these amazing things have to be willing disciples, right? They have to be willing. They must be able. They have to be able disciples. They must be ready to serve at a moment's notice. And as we've talked about previously, they must be dedicated. Dedicated to the cause of Christ, the cause of the church. So here's the thing, being a disciple of Jesus always requires some kind of sacrifice, right? It requires some kind of sacrifice on part of the disciple. There is no easy road, and we're supposed to bring people into church and have the church grow, but I want you to know there's no easy road to being a disciple of Jesus Christ. You know, that don't seem like it's a great thing to tell everybody if we're trying to get people in here and get saved and serve the Lord, but it's not easy. Some days it's the hardest thing you've ever done in your life. Trust me, I know. So, as we're going to see this morning, being a disciple of the Lord Jesus Christ sometimes calls for us to be bold. We're going to talk about Peter being a bold disciple, but it calls sometimes for us to be bold, bold in our faith, bold in our commitments, bold in our actions. We talked about our faith having actions to it this morning in Bible group. And bolden our speech. Last week we began in chapter 3 of Acts, and this morning Mark read for us the rest of chapter 3. And there are so many things we can glean out of this passage in chapter 3. I could probably have 3 messages here in just the last part of Acts chapter 3. But here's what I want to focus on this morning. I want to focus on a man named Peter and his character, his integrity, and how we get a glimpse of all of this in the text. And I want to study Peter here because the Peter we see here in Acts is not the same Peter as we saw back in Luke. If you remember our sermon series in the Gospel of Luke, it's not the same Peter. The Peter we see here is a changed man. If you remember back then, that Peter was a bit of a jerk sometimes. He really was. He was always putting himself into trouble and putting his foot in his mouth. I don't think any of us ever do that, right? No. Because usually he just spouted off what he was thinking. He was a little bold, right? Back then. But then when it came time for him to really be bold, he's the one that denied Jesus three times. So this is a different Peter. So this Peter in Acts 3 that we saw has been transformed. In Acts chapter 2, this is where the transformation began, and Jesus restored him back into the fold. He restored him back into the ministry, and we saw that, and we saw how he continued to have this transformation there in the day of Pentecost when Peter stood up and preached the first gospel message in the church. He's a totally changed man. He's been totally restored. He's been forgiven, and he has the Holy Spirit within him to help him to do the things that he's going to need to do. He's bold, all right, because he has a mission. And there's no longer this Peter that's all about Peter, right? Back in Luke, we see Peter doing things because it benefited Peter. But here in Acts, we see Peter doing things because it benefits Jesus. It's not about him anymore. It's about Jesus. And let me tell you, when a person comes to that conclusion that it's not about me, it's about the Lord, I tell you what, you can count on seeing a changed life. You absolutely can. You can see that person's life change, and the transformation is amazing. Last week we saw how miracles were being done in the new church. A man who had been paralyzed since birth was begging by the temple gate. He expected Peter and John to give him some money, but they walked by and they gave this man so much more, right? Because they gave him Jesus. They gave this man Jesus. And when they spoke the name of Jesus, the man stood up, he started walking, and the people who saw this that were there at the temple were in awe. They were amazed. Verse 11 this morning. While the beggar held on to Peter and John, all the people were astonished and came running to them in the place called Solomon's Colonnade. When Peter saw this, he said to them, "Men of Israel, why does this surprise you? Why do you stare at us as if by our own power or godliness we have made this man walk? The God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the God of our fathers, has glorified his servant Jesus. You handed him over to be killed, and you disowned him before Pilate, though he had decided to let him go. You disowned the holy, righteous one and asked that a murderer be released to you. You killed the author of life, but God raised him from the dead. We are witnesses of this." What we see here is when we look at the new and improved Peter is that bold disciples, right? They stand up for Jesus. Bold disciples stand up for Jesus. We've talked about standing up for Jesus before. So, you know, it's not like this is the first time we've heard this. It's the first time we see it in the Bible. Bold disciples stand up for Jesus over and over and over again, right? I mean, here's Peter right out of in the middle of the temple grounds. He's standing there and telling everyone, look, it's not us that healed this man. It's Jesus Christ that healed this man, right? And he didn't care what anyone thought of him at that point. He no longer cared that he may be arrested and sentenced to death like his Lord was. He didn't care what happened to him at this point because he knew he was doing the right thing by standing up for Jesus. Now, I'm not a prophet, and the Lord hasn't let me in on what's coming in the near future, but I have a feeling the time is coming that true disciples of Jesus Christ are going to have to boldly stand up for Jesus. You know, no matter what the cost. There's the kicker, right? Oh, I can stand up for Jesus, but what's the cost going to be? I think the cost here in the near future is going to become great. Stand up for Jesus, no matter what people think of us. No matter if we get thrown in jail. No matter if we even get killed, right? And that's not an exaggeration because we see bold, faithful martyrs all through church history who stood up for Jesus and lost their lives. I mean, dying for the cause of Christ is not a requirement, but it's not an impossibility either. Got to think about that and consider that. But there is always some sacrifice required to serve the Lord the way he deserves to be served. And there's not one of us, myself included, that shouldn't try to do a better job at doing that and serving the Lord and be the people that, of God that he has called us and created us to be. We need to stand up for Jesus no matter what the tone of popular opinion is, no matter the threat of being shunned or hated by our peers, because we've all been called, as we talked about in Bible group, we've all been called to be ministers. We've all been called to be the people of the church, not just inside these walls, but out in the world. That's where we're called to be the people of God, is out there in the world, right? We need to be bold disciples in every part of our life, at church, at work, at the store, in our homes. And we need to stand up for Jesus even though it's hard. And just like Peter, no matter what may happen, think about it. We think that it's so hard to be a bold Christian in today's society. And it is. Because no one wants to hear about Jesus anymore. Don't tell me about religion and Jesus, and don't beat me over the head with the Bible. That's old ancient stuff. It doesn't apply to our lives today. Nobody wants to be told what's right and wrong. Right? That's our problem today. Nobody wants to adhere to anything that's set right or anything that's set wrong. No one wants to be told that they're a sinner in need of a Savior, and that one day they'll have to stand before a perfect, holy, righteous God to be judged. Well, I got news for you. That's going to happen because we studied Revelation on Sunday nights here a couple months ago now, and people will be judged. By the way, the world's going, these are the truths that people on their way to hell need to hear. These are the truths people right now, today, need to hear. And here's the thing, all it takes for us to be bold disciples and stand up for Jesus and tell people what they need to hear, it takes a little bit of love. Now that might seem counterintuitive that we need to be bold and tell people they're sinners on their way to hell, but we need to do it in love. We need to love people who are lost. Because let's face it, I once was lost, but now I'm found. You may have once been lost, but you've been found. And somebody, somewhere along the lines, loved you enough to tell you about Jesus. Tell you that you are in trouble, right? So, it takes wisdom to be a bold disciple, to deliver a tough message with genuine compassion. But most of all, as we see here, it takes guts. It takes us to be bold. It involves being bold on our part. I guarantee you, Peter wasn't Mr. Popular when he stood up to tell the people either. In fact, there's a good bet that he would have to pay dearly for it, but that didn't stop him. He did it anyway. Because Peter saw an opportunity. He saw that opportunity and he took it. I mean, right here, he had an audience. He had people running up to him saying, "What's going on? How's this man walking? We just passed him and now he was laying there and now he's up walking." He had that opportunity to tell people about Jesus. How many times, though, have we wasted a perfect opportunity? It's like God sets it up. You tease it up, all we have to do is take a swing, tell somebody, and we miss that opportunity. We don't do it. I know I have too many times, but Peter didn't here. He got to tell all the people there why this man is now walking. This man who had not walked ever in his life is now leaping and jumping and praising God. And Peter doesn't have to work too hard to do this, right? It's all set up for him. He just saw an opportunity. The crowd's wanting to know what happened. And Peter simply tells him, Jesus. Jesus is what happened to this man, right? Jesus is the one who made him walk for the first time in his life. Jesus is the one whose powers work miracles. It's Jesus. You know what this world needs today? Jesus, right? That's the answer. Absolutely the answer. They need Jesus. Everyone needs Jesus because Jesus is God. Jesus is Lord. Jesus is our Savior. He's the only one who has the ability to change people's lives today. Listen, Buddha can't do that. Krishna can't do that. Allah can't do that. Some New Age divine life force cannot do that. And I know, here's the thing, that's not a popular thing to say, you know, nor is it a politically correct thing to say that Jesus is the only way, right? But it's the truth. That is the absolute truth. If you want some truth today, only Jesus saves. That's absolute truth. The memory verse for Backyard Bible Club was Acts 4:12, which we'll be looking at next week. It simply says, salvation is found in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given by men by which we must be saved. No other name given to men under heaven by which we must be saved. Salvation is found in no one else, only Jesus. And that's what Peter's telling the people. It's Jesus doing these things. Jesus saves completely, and he changes lives each and every day. As people repent and believe, they're added to his kingdom. That's the way it works. And for all believers, we should all be men and women who are changing more and more to be more like Jesus, right? So even after he changes our life dramatically, after he saves us, after we turn and we're going this direction, we turn, we repent, and we're going this direction. We used to be on our way to hell, now we're on our way to heaven. Even after that, we still need to grow. We are in a constant process of change as we grow in our faith. So another thing we see here is that Peter didn't go out and find a new audience to tell either, right? Because he spoke to his peers. He didn't have to go out and gather up a crowd. He didn't have to go out and find a new people to tell, right? These people were people that Peter probably already knew. These people here in the temple, maybe Peter grew up with and went to school with. The people here in the temple listening to Peter's message may be people he sold fish to when he was in the fishing business. These might be his old customers, some of them. And even if he didn't even know them all personally, he was just like them in every way. They were Jews. He was a Jew. They'd been brought up and raised under a certain set of certain ideas and morals. They all came from the same socioeconomic background. They were all living under Roman rule, and they all hated that. They had a lot in common. These people were just like Peter, and Peter was just like them. The only difference between him and the people there at the temple is he knew the truth, and they had yet to hear it. He understood about Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection, and what the ascension meant. And the people at the temple that day, seeing this man now walking, they didn't have a clue what any of this meant. Peter was a believer in Jesus, and these people were not. So he boldly told them about his Jesus. Let me tell you about my Jesus, Peter said, and let my Jesus change your life. There you go. That's Peter's message right here, right? And where did he begin? He didn't have to come up with, oh my goodness, what am I going to tell these people? Let me go over here. I'm going to sit down. I'm going to write this out. I'm going to rehearse it. He just began to tell them what he knew. He began and he told them what he knew. Now, obviously, they didn't understand a lot about Jesus, but they had been around Jerusalem a little while there, and they probably knew that Jesus was put to death. But now Peter fills them in and fills in the blanks for them, and he tells them the rest of the story. Peter told them in verse 14, here's the thing. Okay, you guys heard about Jesus and how he was put to death. You may have heard some rumors that he rose again, but he's like, let me tell you about this. He said in verse 14, you disown the holy and righteous one and ask that a murderer be released to you. You killed the author of life, but God raised him from the dead. We are witnesses of this. So guys, we don't need to go out and find a new audience, okay? We have people all around us who need to hear about Jesus. We need to just look for and take advantage of opportunities that God gives us where we're at. We need to start where people are and what they know. You know, it's kind of interesting, you know, kind of like in Backyard Bible Club, some of these kids we'd never met before, you know, and it's like, do you go to church? Well, no, or maybe I went to this church or went to BBS last year or something like that, right? You begin with what they know. And then be bold by telling them the truth, because bold disciples, they tell the truth. Verse 16, by faith in the name of Jesus, this man whom you see and know was made strong. It is Jesus' name and the faith that comes through him that has given this complete healing to him, as you can all see. Now, brothers, I know that you acted in ignorance, as did your leaders, but this is how God fulfilled what he had foretold through all the prophets, saying that his Christ would suffer. Repent then and turn to God so that your sins may be wiped out, that times of refreshing may come from the Lord, and that he may send the Christ who has been appointed for you, even Jesus. Here's the thing. Telling the truth to people who don't really want to hear the truth will not win you any kind of popularity contest, all right? Okay, here's an example from today's headlines. How many of you anymore, now be honest, how many of you anymore really think and contemplate before you speak or before you post something online anymore, right? Because of cancel culture, right? Because if you offend somebody, you're canceled. You're done. You get a lot of backlash. You lose the ability to share on Facebook or Twitter or whatever social media you happen to post on. Here's the thing. You may even lose friends that don't agree with you. Used to be if you had a friend and you didn't agree on something, you could agree to disagree. Anymore, I don't agree with you. You offended me. I don't want anything to do with you. Right? You're canceled. You're done. Like, honestly, don't we know it's wrong for men to go into women's bathrooms? Sure we do, right? But can we actually feel like we can voice that opinion anymore? That's just an example. Because we've lost our voice of truth in other matters as well. And as our culture changes and society tells us that wrong is now right, you know, and tells everyone that all things are okay as long as you decide what you want to do for yourself, the fact is culture is now dictating and guiding our moral compass in today's culture and society. See, those things are guiding our culture. Instead of Christians and God directing our ethics and moral in the direction we need to go. When we as Christians who hold to the truths of the Bible don't say a word because it's easier to stay quiet than it is to speak, right? When it's easier to stay quiet than it is to speak, that's a problem. And not to pick on homosexuality because that's been overdone over and over again. But let's go out here. How about other sexual sins, such as adultery, right? Sex of any kind out of wedlock, out of marriage, like fornication. Have you heard anyone speak about those things lately? No. Because they've become okay because society says they're okay. My Bible says otherwise. The Lord says otherwise. What I'm saying is that we need to not go out of our way to speak the truth intentionally cause conflict, but on the other hand, we should never be afraid of telling the truth that's in God's word either. When the opportunity arises, and even then, the way in which we do it must always be from an attitude of love, respect, and not hate. That's hard to do. Trust me, I know. I wrestle with that. We need to tell people the truth because we love them. And because we don't want to see them going to hell. And that's just the truth too. Ephesians 4:15 tells us that we are to speak the truth in love. And that goes for all truth. Which Peter says the absolute main truth is that it's all about faith in Jesus. It's all about faith in Jesus. We've already established that everyone needs Jesus, right? And the only way to receive him into your life is not by doing good deeds or giving time or money to your church, although we'll take it. But, you know, the only way to become that disciple of Jesus is by faith. The only way of spending eternity in heaven in the presence of God is by trusting only in Jesus. Jesus himself said in John 14:6, I am the way, the truth, and life. No one comes to the Father except through me. When people turn to God and place their trust in him, then Jesus can and will restore all things. He will. He can and will restore all things. Just like we see here in Acts 3, the power of Jesus caused a man who had never walked before, a man who had never stood for one second in his life, Jesus made him well. He made him whole. He made him stand up, jump around. Jesus can heal today. It's in His will, right? It's in His will. And we talk about that. Well, if it's the will of God, people I know has been healed of cancer. I mean, literally, I know people who's been healed of stage 4 cancer, while others have not. Mona's cousin just passed away from cancer. We lost her sister a couple years ago from cancer. But my son was totally healed. I have to tell you, I honestly don't know how God works in these areas or how He works in these areas. He doesn't let me in on such things. But I do know that God is love, right? God is love. He loves us all so much that He died for us. I also know that in the end of days, all things will be made new. And for those who trust in Jesus, we will get new and perfect bodies. New and perfect bodies, right? No such things as heart problems or strokes or cancer. Or Revelation 21:4 says, He will wipe away every tear from our eyes. There will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain, for the old order of things has passed away. Amen. Bring it on, you know? Thing is, we all will suffer in this life in some way. And get this, no one will make it out alive. And I believe the statistic still is 10 out of 10 people die, if I'm not mistaken, right? But Jesus can and will restore all things. It's a promise of His. We talked about promises, God's promises in Bible group this morning. And He may not mend or heal our broken, diseased bodies here and now, but I can guarantee you that He can change your life today, right now. Just like that. Trust me, I know, because He intervened in my life and He fixed my life where I'd messed it all up. I screwed it up and I made a mess out of it, but He changed that. Peter tells the people gathered here the same thing. He says, because you know what? This whole mess that you we're in, it's mankind's mess. This isn't God's doing. This is all on you. And it's the same way for us today. Let me be clear here. All the violence we've seen taking place in this past year or so, right? All the chaos, the riots, with people being hurt and killed and buildings being looted and burned to the ground, was a result of fallen humanity. And when these types of things happen, it is a heart problem. It's a hard heart. It's an evil heart. It's a heart that is a result of the fall of man, and people's hearts are full of darkness and they're full of evil. And the longer mankind occupies this earth and the farther they run away from God, things are going to get worse. And at one time, Genesis 6:5 tells us, the Lord saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every intention of his thoughts were in his heart were evil continually. And the Lord regretted that He made man on the earth, and it grieved Him in His heart. So God flooded the earth, and the entire earth was wiped out except for Noah, because Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. So today, thousands of years later, even godless, evil people with darkest hearts can find grace in the person of Jesus Christ. That's Peter's message to these people who killed the Lord. You think you've done some bad things in your life? I don't think we ever killed the Creator of the universe like these people did. Peter says forgiveness is available. Restoration is available. Peter tells people, you know you've all done wrong in your ignorance. You killed the Creator of all life. So now it's time to turn from your wicked ways and what? Repent. Repent. Right? People today need to know that it's time to turn to God. Right now is the perfect time to turn to God. They need to know that they can escape the punishment that they deserve for the wrong things they've done. And all you need to do is repent of your sins and trust in Jesus to save you. That's all that has to be done. That's all there is to it. But they need bold people, bold Christians, bold disciples to tell them that. Verse 21. He must remain in heaven until the time comes for God to restore everything as He promised long ago through His holy prophets. For Moses said, the Lord your God will raise up for you a prophet like me from among your own people. You must listen to everything he tells you. Anyone who does not listen to him will be completely cut off from among his people. Indeed, all the prophets from Samuel on, as many as have spoken, have foretold these days. and you are heirs of the prophets and of the covenant God made with your fathers. He said to Abraham, through your offspring, all peoples of the earth will be blessed. When God raised up his servant, he sent him first to you to bless you by turning each of you from your wicked ways. So here's the deal. As we see here, Peter quoted scripture, so bold disciples, they know their Bible. Truth is, it's easier to be bold when you know God's word. Am I right? It is. We don't have to come up with our own words. We just tell people what the Bible says, and we guide people through the Bible. We don't have to come up with our own words to convince people to turn to Jesus. Studying and knowing God's word is what we all need to do, and I know it's difficult sometimes to find time to, in our busy schedules, to sit down and read and study and understand scripture. Because many people here saying don't like to read or have trouble reading, but I'm telling you, there's other things available. You can go online, download an app, it'll read to you. I'll be honest with you. I'm telling you the truth like I'm supposed to do, right? I'm telling you in love. The only way we can be the men and women of the church that God wants us to be, the only way we can be real Christians wherever we're at, our work, in the store, in our homes, is if we know our Bible. And through it, we know what God wants from us and what God expects from mankind. This is what 2 Timothy 3:16 says. It says, all scripture is breathed out by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and training in righteousness, that the man of God and woman may be complete, equipped for every good work. You may be thinking to yourself, Pastor, you sound like a broken record. Every week you're telling us we need to read our Bibles, right? Every week you're telling us we need to go to Bible study. Every week you want us to go to Bible group. Because every week it seems like you tell us these things, right? And by the way, kids, broken record is something that would skip. See, not only do I have to explain God's word to people, I have to explain old technology too, right? So, yeah, it would hit and repeat and repeat and repeat. So anyway, I sound like a broken record. But God says, you know, like it says here in 1 Timothy, it says the same thing in Acts. And that is, when it comes to the Bible, it gives us warnings. Bold disciples know their Bible because they know it gives us warnings. The Bible's full of warnings. And with warnings, we can avoid bad decisions in our life. Although sometimes we go ahead and do these things, right? And so God wants us to avoid the consequences and the heartache that easily besets us. And that goes along with all these bad decisions we can make. Peter warned them that God sent them Jesus, who was a prophet to them, just like Moses was, and that everyone who doesn't listen to him will be destroyed. The NIV that I read says they'll be cut off from their people, but most translations, like the ESV that Mark read and most of the other ones, say they will be destroyed. And now that is quite a warning, isn't it? If you don't listen to Jesus, Peter flatly said, it's not going to end well. Moses was Old Testament, and Peter used that passage to explain Jesus. We also see part of the covenant, the new covenant, they have warnings as well. Revelation 20. Here's a warning. And if anyone's name is not found written in the book of life, he is thrown into the lake of fire. Pretty clear. Have you ever said, I wish I knew now what I didn't know then, you know? I wish I knew then what I, you know. Well, go through God's word. He's trying to inform us before it's too late. We don't have to go through the consequences. We have a way out. We don't have to know what it's like to go through those things and what will happen. But we do know what's going to happen if you go about your life your own way. There's no doubt about that these warnings are not just for Peter here and the people there at the temple. These warnings are for us today as well. So they're dire warnings. But they're not only... The Bible's not only full of dire warnings because it also tells us the blessings. Let's look again at verse 25 of Acts 3. And you are heirs of the prophets and of the covenant God made with your fathers. He said to Abraham, through your offspring, all the peoples of the earth will be blessed. When God raised up his servants, he sent him first to you, to bless you by turning each of you from your wicked ways. Here's the thing, just the fact that we have the Bible is a blessing. It's a blessing for all of us, right? And we take it for granted. While people in other parts of the world would love to have their own Bible in their own language, some believers don't even pick up their Bible unless it's on Sunday morning to come to church. One of my favorite passages is Psalm 1, verse 1. Blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the wicked, nor stands in the way of sinners, nor sits in the seat of scoffers. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and on the law he meditates day and night. He's like a tree planted by the streams of water that yields its fruit in its season, and its leaf does not wither. And all that he does, he prospers. And finally this morning, being a bold disciple who reads, who studies, who knows their Bible, who becomes bold, also know that it's for our benefit. And godly bold disciples produce other godly disciples, right? And they go out and they get to be bold. And even more and more and more godly bold disciples are produced. And that's what we need today. We need people who are bold enough to go out and tell people the truth. Go out and see wrong, call it wrong. Stand up for Jesus. I know being bold and a godly disciple in today's culture is not easy. I've said that over and over. Because there are so many things in this world that can keep us from doing the things God wants us to do. But just for a moment, imagine this church full of bold, godly disciples. What a difference would that make in Pittsfield, right? What a difference would it make in our community, Pike County? And the place to start with that is with you being a bold disciple. Being a bold disciple here in the church, at your work, in your home, with your friends, with your family, at the store. But here's the thing, to be a disciple, first, you must trust Jesus. You must repent of your sin, turn from your sin, and instead of you being the master of your life, then you allow Jesus Christ to be the Lord of your life. If you've never done that, then here's the thing, you have an opportunity to do that today. I'm boldly telling you that. Today's the day of salvation. You can come forward as we're singing our closing song and receive Jesus as Lord. Or maybe you're here today and you know you got saved and you just don't feel like you're close to God as you used to be. And you know, it's like, I've gone in the wrong direction. I've gotten off track and I want to get back on track. I want to rededicate my life to the Lord. You can do that today as well. Or maybe you're here, got something heavy on your heart, right? And you just need somebody to pray. You can come and do that too. Whatever your need, God's ear is always available and his table is always accessible. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we thank you, Lord, for your word. We thank you for bold disciples such as Peter that gives us an example. Lord, we thank you for your Holy Spirit that guides us and helps us when we need to step up and be bold. Lord, we thank you for the church. As we see, it was in its infancy here in Acts, but Lord, it's getting a little long in the tooth today, and people are not as bold as they used to be. And Lord, we think we can just sit back and let others serve. Lord, I pray that we can all step up the plate, be bold, be courageous, have the strength that we need to do what you want us to do, to be the church in Pittsfield that you want us to be. Lord, that's been my prayer ever since I got here. Lord, but we need you to do that. Lord, if there's anyone here this morning that doesn't know you, I pray they know you before they leave. Lord, if there's anybody who got off track, I pray that they get things right. Lord, if there's anything that's heavy on people's hearts, Lord, help us to lift that and help to lift that burden. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Thank you.
Pray now for our service, Lord. Let's pray now. Lord, we come to you, Jesus, in the name of God and the Son, the name of Jesus, your Son, Lord, who paid the price for our salvation, Jesus. And this is for your benefit. And Lord, we are proud. We are good to be, know that we are. You can use us. You use us, Lord, to bring others to your kingdom, Jesus. And we thank you for that. And it helps us to know that it is really an exciting thing to do. I know it takes courage sometimes, and where sometimes we are ridiculed in a way, but so what if? It's for you, Jesus, and for our eternal destiny, and we all are going to face you, Jesus, and give an account of how we handle your word and your life, Jesus. And, we do thank you again. Help us to go out here and speak for you, Lord, and look for opportunities to speak for you, Lord, because many, many opportunities are there, Lord, and many people are on their way to a place that, one of two places we know. We know Jesus, we know heaven, we know Gehenna, we know what the place called hell is real, and we don't want to go there, no. But anyway, thank you for this time together, and help us to go out and really say, I need to speak for you, Lord. I really do, to experience an exciting thing to do, to know we've led others to you, Lord Jesus. Thank you. In your name we pray, Lord, your will be done in our lives. Amen.